I do not have an agenda in front of me because I didn't print it out. Do I have a motion to accept the minutes from September 28th?
So move.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. I'm going to abstain, I wasn't here, and I'm sorry because I had my record come Tuesday. My fault.
Okay. So everybody agrees except for Tuesday. So the next thing is to review the October 13th public forum.
Do you have to take a vote to accept the minutes?
We did.
Oh, you did? I did.
I'm a petty.
Yes, I was. Paying attention.
Anybody want to review it? How'd it go, guys?
I thought, you know, it was in conjunction with a class that a professor has at Bennington College. So I think it was really worthwhile for people who haven't had much exposure to it. But I think those of us on the board who've been introduced to Act 46 and heard a lot about it for the last couple of months, it was reinforcing, but it wasn't a lot of new knowledge for us.
Yeah.
But they did a lot. They did a nice presentation.
Was there much public there other than the kids from the college?
I think when you subtracted board members, administrators, and students out, maybe 10, 12 people that I did not recognize, so I assumed that they were members of the public. They were not either
at the
board
most.
Administrators or
the school board guy there from Dorset sitting in front of me. Yeah. So they wanted to know about joining.
One of mine rings too.
What's not on the agenda is a, and I don't know why I didn't get on there, review of what we the requests from last meeting. So
okay, we requested our enrollments as far back as they could go. They went back to looks here to 2006, 2005. That's good.
10 years is good.
And here is it on a grid versus the state enrollment. Everything's been hole punched, so you can put this in the binders that you were given last meeting. I keep saying last month, but I think it was actually this month. So, as I was saying, and I don't know if you all heard me, it only, the format that we've been using that you get in your packet every month that shows enrollment only goes back 10 years. That's all we could find in this format. Then it's all by individual school boards, and we would have to reconstruct it. But it's a 700 student drop from 700 plus from September of 05 to October of this year. And one thing I want to point out on the bar graph that you know the that you see the state enrollment and the local enrollment does not have the same years. State enrollment figures haven't been released yet, so that only goes to FY15. We actually included our FY16. We were a little surprised by this. We were making the assumption that here in the southwest corner of Vermont, we weren't as impacted by declining enrollment as much, but you can see since FY06, a 16.67% drop in enrollment locally versus a 9.9% drop in state enrollment. One of the other things that you asked at the last board meeting was a list of, not the last study committee meeting, was a list of consolidated functions under the SU. This is a draft. It is by no means complete. You might even see things that is not listed here that we could add. And not everything here is 100% consolidated. Give you an example, like you'll see, you know, construction slash maintenance. It isn't. We do a lot of sharing, like Woodford this summer. And Powell in the past with help from MAU and BSD maintenance. And under curriculums, unified materials. There is unified materials from the SU point of view, but not, you know, it's not unified across the board with elementary districts. But it's a starting point from your request from from last meeting. And the last document I have to hand out to you is something that's been modified from what Addison Central Supervisory Union put out for their study committee to review. So it's kind of an overview of what Act 46 is, and it has some questions and answers of what most commonly asked questions and some assumptions that you may agree with or not agree with too, as far as savings. But it's really meant as a tool to start our discussion. And some other tasks that we have before us is we haven't set a budget as a committee. We haven't did we make a vote to apply for the grant?
Yep.
Yes, we did do that. Yeah. So
we did vote to apply for the grant. Right. You're right. We haven't set a budget. We set a timeline. I think it's what we were going to meet until June.
See, I have it in the minutes.
We're never going to make the accelerated rate.
Well, if you look at the handout that I gave you, I mean, we really would have to do the accelerated rate. We would have to be there by local elections this spring.
Which won't happen.
Yeah.
I don't think that we should spend much time on that, because we aren't going to make the accelerated timeline.
No.
So let's.
But we did say we'd meet until June.
Yeah.
And come up with our final plan by then.
Jim, I need consolidated functions. Do you think at the bottom there we could add our New England Child Center program at Molly Stark, where all the different.
Yeah, well, we could expand that under special education, because special education doesn't have any bullets.
Yeah, we could do
so
that.
So we could put the NECC program there.
And Congress Street program as well, because they invite all the outlying districts to come for that, too.
Of course, the NECC is really a BSD program, then, which the other districts buy seats in. So, I mean, we are sharing resources.
That's what I'm looking for. Same with Congress. We probably run it, but you know, everybody's invited.
It's the same with Triple E.
Yeah.
Division Street. Yeah. No, starting this coming September, we're going to have to start educating 3-year-olds.
Yes.
10 hours a week.
Yes. Because I read in the paper a couple weeks ago that Arlington, because of that, they can only raise a certain percentage of their budget because of the increase in health insurance and the increase in teachers' salaries, that they are already above that, and they're going to have to start looking at cuts in their budget just to meet the state requirement of staying within that percentage of increase.
We would too.
Which was a discussion at Bennington College. That was part of the discussion at Bennington College. And
I don't know how we sit here.
We heard some of our legislators say they understand the problem and will address it, but if they're not returning to January, and we have to set our budgets
in January,
it's going to be tight. Yeah, some of our districts within our SU are going to be up against that spending limit, paying for the negotiated increases plus child care plus the increase in health insurance.
And health just went up 7.9. So, and then you figure out what it's going to cost you to educate 3-year-olds on top of what we're already paying.
The
teachers' increases, and we got.
Well, I think over.
I hope we're still on.
And then we have to do the, we're doing the paras pretty soon.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, that's this year. We haven't heard from them in the open yet, so.
We can tell the people on Social Security are getting zero.
Mm-hmm. I can. I don't know if that's going to make much difference to anybody. It's working.
I do think that the handout I gave you, the Act 46 study committee titled SVSU Act 46 It's only 4 pages. I'd recommend that you really take some time and read it so that we can launch, I think, many discussions from this, because it goes to some of the questions that I've heard from many of you. I agree with George that the accelerated merger, might be timing out on us, you know, as we approach close to November. And if one board votes no, then we're not eligible for the accelerated merger anyway. So it would have to be unanimous for that. And we need to have the vote by June 30th of 16 and be operational by July 1 of 17.
Now, in studies before, we had to have somebody come in and project our enrollments. Mm-hmm.
Well, I think what would be a good exercise for us to do tonight is what further information would this committee like to see the administration put together? Like an enrollment projection is one that you're saying, and we need to come up with, I think we have one other meeting scheduled, is it the 9th? And we talked about, and we announced that we were going to do that, rotate these throughout the school district. And
yeah,
begin each one with a public forum wouldn't be the right word, but a public segment in which we would encourage people from that particular school district to come and state their feelings and opinions on consolidation so the board can hear it.
But at the last meeting, how long did we want to hold off on that? We wanted to get the information all together first, right? I didn't take a note on it.
Yeah. You needed more substantive discussion first before going out to...
Before inviting other communities.
Yeah. November's was listed for here.
Yeah.
So. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So 411-9, you would like enrollment projections?
It would be nice. And also staffing ratios for over the... as far back as you can go.
I'd like to, Madam Chairman... I'd like to add to that, Jim. There's 5 goals to Act 46, and the only goal that's actionable, in my opinion, in other people's opinion, is goal 3, which is the ratio of students to full-time equivalent staff. Mm-hmm. So it's important. 10 years is fine. If we can go back to 2005, and they use the term full-time equivalent staff, I actually love that.
Yeah.
Full-time equivalent staff. So if we can go back to 205 and get that number, and then that versus now, and then as we're planning a merger.
When we say, you know, staff,
yes,
it does. It gets a little complicated.
Okay.
Because I'll give you an example. Like Mount Anthony wants this for their education committee meeting Wednesday night, but they're really looking at classroom student teacher ratio. So that's you're talking about. You want, whether it's custodians, paras, administrators, teachers.
I would like to see all full-time equivalents, which is everybody, so we have the headcount, which is, it's in the act, and last year's meeting, the Secretary of Education specifically said that's what we have to work on. My number I put on the blackboard was 2,800 students.
By district?
But the whole thing, whatever it adds up to.
And that's not what we already have in the charts here?
No. That's only half of it. So the students is half. We can't change the students, but we sure can change the staff. And what the Act wants to get out is this terrible ratio in Vermont of employees to students.
It's just something under 5.
It could be... I the number I put on the board was 2,800 students, which is light, and about 700 employees, which I'm guessing.
Well, I'm going to argue with you on this one.
Okay, Richard. Okay.
Because I don't think it's fair to count custodians, principals, assistant principals, and secretaries as part of the ratio to student to...
Well, there's two ratios, Jackie. There's one, which is the teachers to student, and that's published nationally, and Vermont is number one in the country. All right. It's 10 to 1.
So yeah, but they're using full-time equivalent people in a building.
When they talk student-teacher ratio, it's all licensed personnel. So it's not what you won't want. It's not the classroom student-teacher ratio. Because that, when we say licensed personnel, that includes anybody who's certified by the state of Vermont versus how many students. So school psychologists, special ed, gym teacher, classroom teachers, administrators. So that ratio, that's in that ratio, and then there's, then everybody else, so.
I like to read section 2, line 3, which is the goals of Act 46. Maximize operational efficiencies through increased flexibility to manage, share, and transfer resources. With the goal of increasing the district level, that's in our case, the supervisor union level, of the ratio of students to full-time equivalent staff, and that includes janitors. That's what that.
I think we could break it down both ways so we can clearly see.
Oh, we can see it. I would like to see it. We can agree upon 4 or 5 broad categories: the licensed teachers.
Which will include more than teachers, any licensed personnel.
No, I would like to see it teachers, and then all the psychologists and social workers described differently.
But if you want to compare it to state averages, you're going to have to do it the same way they do it, which will be all licensed personnel will be in that category.
They don't break it down to just teachers. Yeah.
So I think what we could easily get for you is how many total employees there are.
Yeah.
Or full-time equivalent total employees, because you know we have part-time
exactly,
right.
And then how many hold a license, which then get calculated into what our student-to-teacher ratio is.
Yeah.
That would be.
And I don't know if this is necessary, but
it's mandated.
No, I'm talking about something else.
Oh, okay, sorry. I love you, Jeff.
I was going to bring up something else. But we have seen a huge increase in SPED services over the last, 3 or 4 years at BSD?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. At least?
What? SPED services increased.
Oh, yeah. Oh, way over.
If there's some kind of time, there's some kind of line we can make for that.
So we can see percentage over the same time period?
Yeah. I mean, you don't have to do it for next month. We've got to do budgets pretty soon.
We'll see what we can. It might be more readily available than you think.
Well, just our program at Molly Stark, we have 18 parents just in all that one program.
Yeah, I mean, but it just seems like the whole SPED spectrum has been going up, which we know that is labor intensive. So, therefore, the numbers are always skewed. I don't care what anybody says. When you have an increase of SPED constantly, year after year after year, and you have to keep hiring more staff to take, because SPED kids, the kids that really need it, they require a lot more attention from licensed people.
Delivery of services changes over time, but we'll look at the statistics, because there could be surprises, like the one that we have tonight.
This is a surprise.
We declined at a higher percentage than the state average, which I think we would have speculated at the last meeting that wouldn't have been true. So we won't speculate on this. We'll look at and see how we compare and where our FTE started and where it is now. Do the same time period so that we... Hopefully, we can go back that far. Percentage of special ed then and now.
Is that already on the sheet, Hill?
Yeah. Wait a minute, Mike. Is it on the oldest one?
Yeah, we're at 20.67 this year. It looks like for 15-16. When it goes back 18,
The numbers are very, very clear on how many students you have.
Yeah, no, no, that population has.
Look on the bottom, yeah, you, I know, he's talking special ed, you, Jim's talking staff.
Yeah.
Like I said, I have a number individual, MAU is looking at that individually, and Shasbury is looking at, has requested that information from me too, individually, what their.
Is that bottom line, it looks like?
Their staff numbers are.
Oh, yeah, thank you.
Okay, I see it now.
So you can kind of, at the end, you see the total.
That's gone up.
Roughly, you know, in rough numbers, guess, I.
2% since?
I was told there's over 850 different individuals who draw a paycheck of some sort within the SU.
Whoa.
But the full-time equivalent is somewhere in like the 630 range, but I'll verify that and get that breakdown, because, you know, you have coaches who work somewhere else, come in coach more, so they would be somebody who has a job number on our payroll.
Yeah.
So that's where that number gets inflated. Okay. So for next meeting, I have enrollment projections, staffing ratios, with all FTEs by district, include all staff, and break down by licensed staff, versus total staff, percentages of special ed, then and now.
I'm sorry. I can't focus. We should think as a committee, what we really would like to consolidate, if anything. You know, so that we can start working towards our approach that what we think is feasible to consolidate.
Think you'll get a consensus on that?
Well, if I make people think about it.
Yeah, and that's the 4-page document that's here tonight is to get you to think about it. I know that some people, we want to try and keep this open mind on all of this as long as possible. And we all bring our own thoughts, feelings, presages, what you know, to these meetings, but.
Because there, if you look at this right here, there are other things that could be added to this.
Yeah.
Even if you eventually decide you want to stay the way you are.
But Donna Leap, Rick Pembroke, and I were meeting today on this, and one of the things that was mentioned in that meeting, that the more we consolidate into the SU, we might anger some more of the voting public because they don't vote on that SU budget. And that's one of the flaws of that third option that we keep talking about, that we're already consolidated enough, we don't need to go the route of, you know, a merger.
You're absolutely right.
Yeah.
But there's, I believe, that the supervisory could vote to have the public vote on our budget.
Well, that's something we could research. I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In fact, George, the towns, it's not that clear, but the towns vote on, in Pownell, part of our budget is supervisory union and part is local, and the town votes on the combined. Maybe we, as a town of Pownell, I'm thinking of bringing up at our next meeting, is that for the purposes of the vote, we just split out the, you know, we have the town portion and the supervisory union portion. It comes to the same total. Mm-hmm. Everybody's doing it now. That's just a simple solution.
Probably.
So it's endless, nobody votes on it. Well, of course they vote on it. It's just not that obvious.
Well, they don't understand if they vote on it. And the problem with starting to break out things is things can go down. Mm-hmm. And the part of the SU budget, the biggest part of the SU budget is the special ed. And if that goes down, where are you going to get the money?
But if we come into compliance with the latest state's regulations on transportation, is all going to be shifted to the SU.
Mm-hmm.
And the SU budget is going to go up. The individual district budgets will go down, but your assessment, well, it really wouldn't, because your assessment, you're gonna have to cover your SU assessment in there, come in compliance with the second part of the issue that we're dealing with on one bus transportation. We were, as we investigated whether Pownell could continue to offer their own transportation, then we were informed by the state that we were out of compliance, too many acts, it was at 166 we were out of compliance with, because DUFOR bills each school district individually, and that's not allowed. DUFOR has to build the SU, and then we have to, on a per pupil basis, shift it back out. So we're gonna have to come into compliance. We got a 1 year waiver on that because we're already in this budget year, but as we build next year's budget, you know, so I'm just sitting back right now wondering how that's going to affect the SU budget. And as we, because the other thing that's been mentioned for consolidation is facility maintenance. So, you know, that would come out of your local budget and come into the SU budget. And the SU budget continues to grow, yet nobody votes on it. So that would just antagonize people more.
So you're saying that the new way they're going to do the busing is by per capita? So you mean like Bennington does 70%, so they would pay 70% of the busing?
Yeah. I think you're paying that anyway, so. You're paying, you're getting direct billed by what your buses are anyways.
So yeah, we only need so many buses because we only have so many kids. Because I get to high school, a lot of the kids drive to school who live in Bennington. So they're not on the bus, so if those kids all didn't drive, we probably would need another bus or two. So if you go the way you're talking, we're going to be paying a lot.
The way the state's talking.
Yeah. We're going to be paying a lot of busing costs that we don't even have the kids on the bus. So if we have 1,000 kids from Bennington, and that's our assessed number, and yet only 800 really ride the bus because 200 are high school juniors and seniors, and they take their car to school, we're going to end up subsidizing the outlying district.
It's not...
I don't think it's going to be that way.
Yeah. The only adjustment I've seen...
Nobody in high school in April, May, and June with the 16-year-olds start turning 8, and that right now there's a lot of empty spaces.
Hey, look, I pick up a kid at the Molly Stark School, and I'm there. Why am I paying for buses?
There's just as many cars at Molly as there are at the high school.
With the parents picking up kids in there, why are we paying
the initial numbers we looked at does not impact BSD. There's a slight increase to Woodford and possibly Shaftesbury, but not BSD at this point. It's basically done the same way you're doing special ed right now. How's that assessed out? Yeah.
What you use.
But the absolute cost for the supervisor union, no matter how it's allocated, doesn't change. We just
correct
rearrange the deck chairs as they say. And I just want to go on record that this SU budget is voted for. It is voted for. Thank you.
And we have tried to explain that in so many numbers.
Well, every time somebody says not voted for, I say yes, it is. And I am going to propose a panel that we split it out.
I'm just cautioning you because you're going to have to make up the money out of your other budget to make up for services that you have to provide.
Yeah. So in Pownell, you have two different votes on the ballot, one for the SU and one for the
I'm saying if we split it out,
that's what they
then
want
people would see it.
Okay.
I mean, the SU is included in the Pownell budget.
The assessment to the SU is included in the Pownell
budget. And it's in the detail that you can all read at the, at the town meeting. But it's just one big number, 4 or 5 million, whatever it is.
Would not give
and our SU assessment is in there very clearly. Mm-hmm. And with 2 minutes effort, you can find it.
I would not give anybody that shot.
Maybe in the wording, the people are worried about this, maybe in the wording, you may put down like the Bennington budget is $9.5 million, of which... $2.5 million is of SVSU assessment. You could do something like that. So it would be clear to people what part of their
very good can. I like that.
Something like that.
Yeah, I wouldn't separate them. So you vote
change
separately.
Change proposal to that. I like that. I really do. Thank you.
Well, this study committee has no authority for that.
No, I'm just saying, but at the Powell meeting, I'm gonna recommend that we do that. You know, to, you know, of the $4 million school budget, you know, 1.2 million is supervisor union assessment. That was one number they're voting on.
I do think we have to have more discussions along what Jackie's suggestion is. What is the goal of this study committee? What is our mission? What can we come to an agreement on? We can, I can flood you with facts and figures and fill the requests for information, but at the end, we're gonna have to make a recommendation to our boards of, you know, where we wanna go with consolidation. And where, you know, what that recommendation would be. And we wanna hear from the public on this, and we really gotta put a mechanism together for doing that.
I really would like to see, one of the things I'd like to see if there was a merger is what actually are the increased educational opportunities? Because financial, they come, they go, they fluctuate. You're never guaranteed. I don't care. They can tell you you're gonna save $1 million and $2 million a year, a couple years later you got right back. I've seen it come and go. But educational opportunities is what I would like to know. You know, if a merger was to take place, what it would look like and how would we all benefit? And how would the students benefit? And it really upsets me that you tell me that we have the same curriculum, but we don't.
No, we have the same curriculum. It's curriculum materials that the materials that the SU provide, but individual buildings at different grade levels still. You know, we have one, you know, I don't know, Donna, if you want to speak to that. I know you're also operating the camera back there, but this is really more your area of expertise, and we were discussing this today, so.
Yes, I'm curious about what you mean, though, Jackie. There is a core curriculum we have that's aligned with the state standards that is in English language, arts, math, social studies, science, arts. Check online, they're there.
Mm-hmm.
I think that we're getting much closer to having everyone be aligned to that. I think it's taken some time through our purchase of materials and through the work that the teams have been doing at all the grade levels in each subject area as a focus. But we're getting very close, and check online in the curriculum tab, it's all there now, which is really, I've really made an effort to get that all posted so that everyone has a consistent curriculum. And I would say that we purchase what we see as the core resources for the SU and encourage everyone to be using those as their primary resource. So we have programs like Foundations and Early Literacy that is common to every school in grades K to 3. We're also aligning pre-K to that now. And also our math resources that we just purchased. You know, last year was our first year with Go Math, and we've seen really it's hard the first year while everybody needs an awareness of that and how that all looks and what the content and the concepts are. But this year, we've heard really good feedback about the outcomes of our students. It's very, very exciting to see when it is implemented. People have found that the new materials are very helpful to align to the standards, and students are doing very well where it's being used. It takes at least a year for everyone to go through every page of those new materials to know what's there. And this year, we will see a big surge for it.
The thing that would bother me is they all have to take a test in grade 2, and each one of the districts is maybe using something slightly different.
But don't we all use the same textbook? I thought everybody in third grade in the district would be using the same textbook. So if a kid left Ben Allen and went to Shaftesbury, that they would have the same textbook. Maybe not at the same pace, maybe they're accelerated or not, but wouldn't they all use the same textbook? Because I thought textbook purchases were put in the SU budget.
The programs that are SU programs are consistent across the schools. But other people sometimes bring in other resources that they've liked, that they've used before.
But they use supplemental.
To supplement the core program.
But wouldn't that be the principal's job to make sure that all the kids are getting the same material throughout the district?
That's where we monitor assessments, Ken.
We do. And it's also, you know, if you read the document I gave tonight, not, part of the issue of our structure is principals wondering who they actually work for.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, so do they take their directive from the superintendent? Or do they take it from their own individual school board? And it's a difficult place to be for the principal. I'm not, and maybe not so much here, but what the state of Vermont has experienced as far as leadership turnover, that, you know, could be a contributing factor also, so.
And the reason why this is a big problem to me, because I had a child go through this, is they went from one school in BSD to another school in BSD, and they were learning something totally different on that grade level. So.
We're getting better. I want to tell you that.
But 20 years ago, you were on the board when Tom and Helene and we went, and we all agreed, all the boards agreed, that we would buy our curriculum together and we would set it up grade level so that when all, if you move from Pownell to Molly Stark to Woodford to Shasberry, that you would be going, getting the same unit of work. And
by and large, I think that's an accurate statement, but does it mean that there aren't, as Donna said, supplemental materials being used in different schools, you know, as an enhancement to what SU is providing?
It used to be a huge issue when they all entered the middle school because they had all learned something different.
Yeah.
That's why we've got a consistent math resource all the way through the middle school.
But you really want that to show up at the end of your program. You want principals and educators to have latitude to use what they like best or what their students use best or the current event issues that might apply or any of those things. I think you need that result when they go from grade to grade. I don't think you're ever going to get it going from school to school if you're changing horses in midstream. I think you're always going to find different teachers with different methods.
Well, you're going to find it accelerated or decelerated too.
Yeah, I just think you shouldn't demand a lockstep, I guess, is what it sounds like.
But I would like the same materials taught in the same year.
Well, they do have that now.
And that's part of what the Common Core is. But methodology of how a teacher gets to that is always going to be that individual
difference.
Yeah.
I would also add that the principals have been working much more closely as a team and coordinating their instructional practices throughout all the schools. And they really have started to help each other. They're not working in isolation anymore. We're really bringing them together as a team to look at data across all of the schools.
Minimum of once a month, but it's really been closer to twice a month right now.
Yeah.
Especially with our transient population. We have a huge transient population.
So if we are trying to determine a goal here, should one of our goals be to take a look at
curriculum?
At consistency in curriculum? I mean, if ultimately we're going to say, we're already doing this, we don't need to change anything to meet a new state requirement, shouldn't one of our goals be to establish that we actually are what you're looking for?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I do think that we're not going to be able, you know, we're going to have to, if that is our, and I'm only repeating what I've heard from some of you and other board members, that we're fine just the way we are. If that is what we're saying, or we're already consolidated enough, and we are, compared to some SUs that still have individual teacher contracts by district. I mean, you know, that was taken care of years ago. Curriculum is, at least the design of the curriculum is universal throughout the SU. So we are ahead of other districts as far as consolidation goes. But we're gonna have to back up and document, so you're absolutely right. That if we're gonna say, as an example, that our curriculum is universal, so we're already consolidated in that, so we don't need to go further, if we probably should make sure that that's a valid statement.
Or if we find out we need to go further, at least we've identified it and we can work toward it.
And I think that we need to look at a lot of these things to make sure that we actually are all doing them.
Yeah.
And there may be some areas, after we read this paper that our superintendent passed out tonight, that we can get from there to add to what we are doing.
You can tweak.
Yes.
As needed.
Jackie?
Yes.
The superintendent brought up the relationship of principals and superintendents.
Mm-hmm.
And Act 46, which is what we were working on, Section 47 mandates that the Secretary of Education deal with the principals. It's a principals and superintendents study and proposal. And she has to get that done by January 15th, in 4 months from now. But as far as...
What page?
Page 57, Section 47. It's short. Honor before January 15th, the Secretary of Education, in consultation with the Vermont Superintendents Association, the Vermont School Boards Association, and the Vermont Principals Association, shall develop and present to the House and Senate Committee on Education a proposal to clarify the rules of superintendents as system managers and as principal, and principals as instructional leaders. The proposal shall also address superintendents and principals' relative responsibilities of supervision and evaluation. So this whole question of who they work for, they're going to get at there. So the Secretary of Education has been charged with that. And while I'm speaking, I'll be a broken record on this. This is an Act 46 committee, and the Act gives us some goals, and I think everything we do should be within those goals. Thank you.
Well, I think it is within goals if we look at all the things that we've done to consolidate and make sure that they are consolidated and see where we can go from there to consolidate more. And if we're looking at increased educational opportunities, a lot of that's going to come out in curriculum, special education, and we look at those things, student management, technology, financial benefits, like I said, that goes up and down. I don't think you're...
I think one of the selling points we would have is that with our ACORNS program, if we took those 18 youngsters and said that we could not service these and they had to go to Boston, let's say, for a day camp, I think the district would be assessed around $200,000 to $225,000 per youngster. Now, I know the state pays 90% over $50,000. But even paying that, if we do them in-house for, say, $75,000 a youngster, we're saving the state, you know, almost $100,000 per kid times 18. We're now saving the state almost $2 million just with our in-house program that we've designed here. The family gets happy because the kids come home every night. They're not spending time in Boston. They don't get to see them only once a week or every other week. So I think there's in a Congress Street, again, and we have kids going to Pittsfield, to the Berkshire School down there. This district does a lot for our needy youngsters here. Mm-hmm. And we actually, you know, we do what's best for the kids, but we're also doing something that saves the state a lot of money. We could easily say, oh, these kids, we can't service them, let them all go away into a day camp over in Boston or something. And it would kill the state and it would kill the families too. But I think we're doing a good job when it comes. And I've heard of people that move into this district because they've heard how much we really do for our needy youngsters. So, you know,
A couple of things that, as superintendent, I want to point out.
Yep.
There are 47 board members.
That's right.
You know, some of you are doubled because you're also on the SU board. But 47, and that doesn't include the alternates on the SU board. We put together 7 budgets. We have to track back the spending of, for accounts receivable for 7 different, you know, districts. 7 different audits have to be prepared for. 7, minimum of 7 board meetings a month agendas have to be prepared for. That's a lot of manpower.
Mm-hmm.
That's a lot of work. And so does it have an impact on, you know, I think, you know, Jackie, you asked about what is education, what does it mean for the students? It's tough to be the educational leader when you're preparing for 2 board meetings a week, not per month, a week. Luckily, I'm lucky that I have an assistant superintendent who does a lot of the work with the principals, that so I'm dealing here. It's not, this is not a superintendent whining that he goes to too many meetings. I knew what the job was when I signed up for it. But the sustainability of it and the economics of it, I do question. Yet I understand how passionate some of you are about maintaining your individual board, because you want that oversight over what you hold dear to you, your own individual schools. But Act 46 isn't about closing schools. It is about consolidation and savings. And the efficient use of personnel is part of that. It's just, you know, tracking spending alone, and 7 different payrolls prepared every month. It's a lot of work. So,
but Jim, I understand what you're saying, but that it's you and your staff's job to show this committee where what can be saved if there is consolidation.
Right.
So I'm not completely convinced that even though there's that work, mm-hmm. I want to see on paper where the efficiencies are going to be if we consolidate it.
This isn't just about saving money, though.
Yeah, but I know. But
it's about efficiency,
mm-hmm.
which isn't always money. It
can yeah.
be personnel and allow you to focus on some of the, like, the curriculum issues that you're talking about,
mm-hmm.
And or observations of principals, which is so. Yep, money's a big part of it, but an efficient operation. I mean, 2,800 students overseen by 47 different school board members does seem to be a high ratio. We talk about, you know, student teacher ratios, school board to student ratios. That's a pretty high ratio too.
It all arises from the Vermont Constitution, where every town is about 250 towns, and every town is mandated to have a school district of some sort, and everything else goes after that. That's why we have about 250 towns and about 250 school districts, and it does say in there the legislature can change that, and that's what they're trying to do right now. They're looking, and the more, the Secretary of Education, and whatever we do has to be presented to the Secretary of Education. She will do whatever she does, and then she'll send it to the State Board of Education for final up or down vote. And both the Secretary of Education and the Vermont State Board of Education have clearly stated at their last September meeting, if you watch the video, that the only thing they can really look at is number 3. It's this thing about ratios. The rest is off. It's fluff. We can write, if we have somebody that's an excellent writer, we can argue it, and it can look pretty and all that kind of stuff. But it's all about what's driving it is that it appears that we have too many employees and we're spending too much money.
And 80% of our budget is personnel.
It's personnel. So they have said that when the Act 46 committees present their presentation, 1 and 2, okay, you know, and 4 and 5, okay, but number 3 is the only one that we can really take a honest look at. It's the ratio. So what I'm trying to get at is, over the last 10 years has our full-time employee ratio, the student ratio, gone up or down? We're at about 4, and I can't find the notes from last year, but she said we should be at 6. Does that ring a bell?
No, she said if they could get over 5 statewide, mm-hmm. they would save $70 million.
Okay, yeah. So we're at 4. So if we're at 700 employees, to get to 5.
I think it's more like 630, but. But we'll get, you know, we're.
Yeah, it's
we've requested
it's,
those
it's
numbers.
It's a bunch
tonight.
Of people.
You know,
it's a bunch of people. And the consolidation will show us, if we look at it honestly, you know, yeah. really honestly, all right. If we wipe out my job, that's fine. Okay. I mean, one thing that's a benefit the superintendent could spend, boy, I can't believe I'm arguing for this. The superintendent could spend more time in the schools, et cetera. Okay? Yeah. And more time at the he would spend it, instead of at school board meetings, he'd be at all the basketball games and all the plays and all the.
And looking at some of the other things that I see a benefit of consolidation is the flexibility on staffing. And I've said this before, district wide, the new district, if that happened that way, you know, I have a declining enrollment at the high school, 6 teachers retired. We replaced all 6 of them. Did that have to happen, or could there have been savings where I know that at Monument I have very high kindergarten numbers right now.
And they probably could have went to another school.
And they could have went to another school.
They could have come to Powell.
They could have, but I'm restricted by town lines, which I wouldn't be under this. We could look at who's bordering, and you know, a matter of a bus going by a different street, we could balance all class sizes equally, which I don't believe that we do have that equity. That gets to the equity question. Are class sizes equal? Does everybody have a math interventionist or the access to one? No. Does everyone have the amount of reading coaches that they have? Even within the BSD, I don't even think I have equity, you know, there, or the ability to shift from, because they're all employees of individual school boards. So I don't have the efficiency of balancing. I don't know, we could have 40 kids up in Woodford, maybe. I don't think that there's that. I don't know what the capacity of the building is, but there's. Do I think that there could be some students from Bennington that would, you know, want opt to go there? Yeah, I do. So again, it's not about closing schools, but it's about optimizing it and reducing employee to student ratios. Yeah, absolutely. That's where the savings is going to be.
What's the number of students in Monument?
100 and
no, I'm sorry, in the kindergarten.
23.
And we're looking at 11 or 12 in Palm.
There you go.
And I brought it up at our meeting in public. Why didn't we do something? You know.
Yeah.
And then our fifth grade. Okay, we have 3 fifth grades because we were a bubble.
Yeah.
All right. And
we have that somewhere in ours.
Yeah. So we're hiring people. So that part is of interest to me. If that's, you know,
if you want to really reduce the ratio of student to staff, we need to look at that type of revenue. Resource sharing, and by that I mean, you know, personnel, not just curriculum.
So does that mean we've got to take a look at charters that restrict those kind of things?
That would have to be done. The Bennington charter would have to be voted on and disbanded.
Yeah. Because you could do that without consolidation.
Sure, you could.
I don't, you know.
Well, but you have a hard time moving people around now,
yes.
Because
now we're talking
was it Bennington's charter says Bennington will provide education for
but even
students.
If we had a charter change, Bennington would have a problem with it because we have 3 buildings to operate. And if we lose students, because the budget is a Bennington budget, you know what I'm saying? Right now, when we have to look at a budget, we're looking at how many students we have and cost per student, and that's what we build our budget on. If I move 5 kids to Pownell, I lost those 5 kids.
The so money follows the kids.
The money follows the kids. I still have that same space, but if we're an SU, the SU takes care of everything.
To
we have to run it as the pre-K through 12 structure, or can we run it one of the other alternatives?
Do the elementary structure.
I mean, could you do the, you know, because they offer that pre-K and you tuition in to K through 12.
Well, you probably could petition for anything, what they would accept. Remember, their preferred structure is a pre-K through 12 school district. So in, you know, if I interpret the state, the entire district would mimic how the MAU board functions. It would, you know, that's a regionally elected board, so then they don't have to deal with proportionate, but you could do proportionate votes, but be one board. So what you're doing 7 through 12 right now, you would be doing pre-K through 12.
And you could run that option with the 7 to 12 kids tuitioning in, correct?
I think every option's up for discussion, so, you know, could you, so you mean that...
So you don't have to send your kids to Mount Anthony, you can send them to Arlington?
I read somewhere,
you can do the pre-K through 6,
then
you can
K
do the
12.
K through 12, or you can do the K through 12, mm-hmm. you can leave the
no, man, I don't think you'd see
7
much,
through 12
out there
by themselves.
Well, the issue, one of the issues for one of our SVSU members for North Bennington is they have school choice, you know, pre-K through 6. And are we allowed to have them be part of, you know, because I believe the state has said that you can't be a tuitioning district and an operating district at the same time. So if they merge with us, do they lose their ability to tuition into the village school? So then if that's the case, I can't imagine that they would want to join us, which gives rise to another option that the state calls the side-by-side district, so that they, you know, we could merge, they could stay, so that's two SUs operating as one, and one could deal with the tuition piece, and one could be the operating piece. There's so many options, but I mean, the state is telling us right now that they're, the last meeting I went to, and I have another one this Thursday on it, there are 26 SUs that are actively pursuing consolidation in some way, shape, or form right now in the state.
Are we counted in that 26?
We have a study committee, and they're aware of that, but... yeah, I think we might be in that 26 count. I think they said there are 13 that look like it right now will be meet the accelerated deadline and maybe more. I think, and I'm talking, you know, don't hold me to these numbers. Maybe this is there 56 SUs in the state?
That sounds about right. 61, I think.
Yeah, and then anyone that has a, you know, there are. Joint border, like they're in New Hampshire and Vermont, you know, then they're not part of this discussion, so they come out of it. And so I think, yeah.
The thing you mentioned about we could move teachers if they were in Powell or the numbers were down, that could be solved if we could get that in a teacher's contract, that the teachers become SVSU employees like our SPED teachers are.
Yeah.
And then you could say, well, we got an extra one at Monument, so we can move that one over to
we
there.
We tried to talk about that at teachers' negotiations. I didn't get to
it. So we could do that, but it goes back to that earlier problem is the SVSU budget will explode if we put all teacher salaries into the SVSU
budget.
And
we also have problems with certain school boards that like to hire their own teachers, and they believe their teacher is their teacher.
As opposed to giving the superintendent the authority to transfer, that would be.
I don't know if we still have that problem, but I know in the past that has been a huge issue in a couple of the districts.
One thing that bothered me, I mentioned that the meeting we had at Bennington College, is that the state has a group of school districts that have what they call ghost students.
Yeah.
And give an example, if they had 200 kids in their school district last year, and this year they have 180, they lost 20 kids. But the state uses a maximum of 3.5% loss. Yeah. So the state says, really, you only lose 7. So they're going to get 13 the value of 13 kids that are not even there, but they're going to get money from the state to run their school.
And yet we're going to be held to a 2.5%
Yeah, and those, and if it's 10,000, that means they get $130,000 for kids they don't have, and that's going to be for the next few years.
Right,
and
if that they lose away, but it is still active.
And if
right
they
now
lose another 20, they're still going to be basing on the original just 3.5 again, so they could be down to 160. And they'd be getting like this extra 25 or 30. So sometimes I wonder, you know, I know in Washington, D.C. and stuff, there's a lot of lobbying that, you know, some groups get with their way because they have connections and stuff like that. And this happened. And, you know, instead of saying, yeah, our goal is to keep the tax rates down. If we just tell these people, you lose that, here's a chance. You lose 20 kids in a K-5 school. You lay off one or two bodies. And you're going to survive, and you're going to do what you have to do. You can't wait 3 years to lay off people and keep those big numbers of staff. So sometimes
goes
I think that
to
contributes
their
to why Vermont has the lowest, one of the lowest student teacher ratio in the country. One of the contributing factors.
Yeah. Well, I mean, they don't have the
phantom students that you know, the whole basically like a hold harmless clause that if you're reducing, you're losing students, the state will only reduce your state money by no more than 3.5% a year.
That doesn't
even
move the needle that much on the ratio.
Yeah.
It's part
over
of it.
Time it does.
It's part of it.
Over time. Because you've had, you know, if you have
well,
schools that are overstaffed
paid
based on declining.
Kids that aren't even there.
But if you, that goes to providing equity. You can't provide equity if you're paying a school for kids they don't have when the other school took them.
Well, they may have moved out of state.
Or they just don't exist. You know,
yeah, they don't exist.
Yeah.
But if we took them.
Because of declining population.
It goes on a 3-year average.
Oh, I know. Yeah,
that's
what
we get
this
paid
question,
on.
And it's, you know, it's a lot of money that the state pays out. And I think they're going to stop it after 18. But in the meantime, there's hundreds of thousands of dollars each year being paid out for kids that aren't there. And the rest of us have to pay that amount for that. I don't think we here in the supervisor union have, you know, overstaffing. I mean, I see the numbers, I see the.
Well, we're going to have that for the next meeting, and we'll see what that looks like. Just, you know, we sat here last time and not thinking that our student numbers were declined quicker than the state. So let's see what our staffing numbers are.
I just looked at the BSD. In 08, the BSD had 839 youngsters. This year we got 816. So we lost 23 kids in the last 7 years. So that's about an average of 3 kids lost a year. I don't think that's a big number because we could get 5, 6, 7 next year and 7, and then we'd be right back.
It's not a big enough number to give you funding under the phantom student.
No.
No.
But that's like 3 years. Yeah, we don't lose that. But I mean, I'm just saying, as a district, we don't lose that many youngsters. I don't think.
And you can't.
Remember, Mrs. Miller mentioned how much Shaftesbury dropped. She said they really dropped.
I'm just looking at Shaftesbury. They're down from 250 to 200. They're down 20%.
Where did they go?
240.
No, we're
at
240.
They're
at
240, yeah.
But they used to have like 350.
Yeah, it's 20, like 10, 15 years ago, it's like 350. But if you go back to 2008 here, you're at 190, I think. Shaftesbury, 194. So we picked up 50 kids.
So it was the opposite.
They were
202, and it went up.
If you go back to 2000, 1998, and stuff like that, I think they had like 350 in Shaftesbury.
But did you pick them up from North Bank then?
This year? I think we only had a couple.
They're trying.
I think we only had.
I was just wondering.
We only had three or five. I want to say we had somewhere 5, 6 kids pushing in, but not much.
Yeah.
Three.
No. What we need next time.
So as Richard's saying, those projections are going to make a difference mm-hmm. then. And mm-hmm. Did we, on another subject, we seem to beat things to death, I think, but Jim had some questions about 706 and about how whether or not we fixed either the voting arrangement or the members of this committee. Have we really got that figured out yet?
Oh, weighted voting.
It's weighted, but we have a, I don't have it with me tonight, the weight. weighted voting, the same way it was calculated when you did the red committee.
So this is us, though?
This is us, right, yeah.
Is there a gentleman, is there from North Bennington, is not here tonight?
Yeah, it's Matt Patterson, they elected him, yeah.
He didn't come to the last meeting.
I saw him, he wants to come, he has a conflict on his nights, he's gonna try to make it.
What I don't understand is that they don't have representation K-6 because they have their own private school.
Yeah.
But this is the high school, but the high school doesn't have any representation, so I don't understand how that works.
Every town that had, every school district that sends students to high school is here.
District's really important in the law. What Dick was talking about,
Bennington's lost 200 students in 10 years. Bennington Elementary, it's 200 students less than it was 10 years ago.
Just that one elementary school, you mean?
No, all your, 10 years ago, you had four elementary schools.
Yeah, but 160 or whatever are up at the middle school.
You're at.
Sixth grade.
Yeah.
Because I'm just counting the K-5, we've lost, like you say, 23 and.
And the kids and the sixth graders still considered BSN kids.
Is our meeting on the 9th gonna be here?
Yes.
When you talk about equities, that's probably one of the bigger ones, with the biggest ones, with the.
6 o'clock, Jim.
Yep, and I have a list of what information you would like for that meeting. 6 o'clock on the 9th. Is there anything else that you would?
Yes, on the agenda, what Dick was talking about was section 9. Self-evaluation, this is an Act 46 exploratory committee. I would like at the next meeting for us to evaluate section 9.
Is it section 9?
Section 9, self-evaluating, self-evaluation meetings and proposal. That's something else we could be doing, okay? And it's not under 706 and all these tight rules about proportionality. But I think this is more of what we're doing, self-evaluation, section 9. If everybody, put that on. 17. And that's why, and.
What are you asking that we do, you want us to?
Consider whether or not this section is more appropriate than what we're doing. Because under section 9A1, self-evaluation, the board shall evaluate its current ability to meet or exceed each of the goals set forth in section 2 of this act, which is what we're doing, okay?
And you think you're gonna get that done by the 30th?
No, I'm just saying, I'll put it on the agenda for us to talk about.
But that's referring to each individual board.
Yeah, the boards get together. The board shall meet with the boards of one or more other districts, including those representing districts that have similar patterns of school operation and tuition. So if we can just look at it, to my reading it, it's something else that we could have been doing instead of this section 706. 706 has always existed, and we've always had the opportunity to do that. And I think what we're doing is, this is a little more, I think this is what George is thinking about. We're gonna look and see if we're okay. And this here will tell us if we're okay. It's a little less stringent.
It's not.
I'm not arguing for it, I'm saying.
Yeah, it's not that, I don't think we, I don't know if we can. I think you can refer that back to your own individual boards, because that's the charge of those boards, not the study committee, which was formed by the SU.
Yeah, that has to go back to your own board.
I would say, let's discuss it next time.
But still, you get to report here what we're doing, and that makes a composite picture.
Yeah.
Part 2 is meet with other boards, what we're doing.
What do you got, Ken?
I, like the state hands out propaganda. I got 3 pieces here, propaganda to hand out for yourself. These were a couple interesting articles that showed up in the Rutland Herald. I gave one for each of that one, and then one each of that one. And this is something the state put out. If take one of these. Are you folks interested in any of these?
I thought you already handed these out, or was it you had given them to me?
Oh, maybe you.
That's what the.
Here's a copy.
Maybe something today, the governor's wanting to repeal 36.
I think you already have the fact sheet.
I'm not catching up to it. I mean, that, was that?
Which one you got?
Yes.
Ken, what, how many things do you have over there? Two?
Three.
This one.
I think we are. I think that's what we're doing. That's how this committee was formed, yeah.
I think we're doing a nine, not the other.
No, I think it's one and the same.
Do we have anything else we want to bring forth at this meeting?
Is anybody really dying to read that red binder that George passed on? I'm only about halfway through it.
I have my own copy, so.
Oh, okay.
Give us a report.
That's where I saw the ratio thing.
Yeah.
Right, 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 right.
That's.
I'll make a motion, we adjourn.
Oh, wait a minute, can I ask a question?
Sure.
State your name, please.
Yes, I'm Erica Mitchell, and I just have a question, because I just wanted to know where this, if this group has talked about or the question about school choice, is, I think one of the pieces that's a little bit unclear, that there's, it seems to me there's a lot of conversation about whether this act actually impacts school choice. I don't have any opinion, I'm just curious.
I'm on the VSPA, Vermont School Board Association, and I always try to bring it up that I, as you know, probably the high school kids in Vermont can go to any high school they want, they have a choice. In other words, you mentioned your youngsters, they could go to Arling, they can't go to like BBA, that's a private school, but if they want to go to Rutland High School or Essex and stuff like that, Brattleboro, as long as they get there, they could go to that school. I always try to talk about choice for all those kids, like you do in Massachusetts, you know, K through 12. Let the kids go where they'd like to go. But up in Montpelier, they keep telling me, oh, it's not fair. And the thing they use as a crutch is transportation. They keep saying, well, what only the rich kids can get from this place, because their parents have a car and they can do. But I worked at Mount Greylock in Williamstown for over 30 years, and Reesboro and Stanford were choice districts. Those kids could go anywhere. And what they did is they got five sets of parents. One morning on a Monday, one would bring the kids to the bus stop in North Adams, and then that same person would pick them up. And then the next day, so one parent was only responding. I mean, you can be done. I mean, you know, it's just a crutch. People say, well, we don't want to do it because some parents can do it and not. But I think that is just, you know, a lot of baloney. I think where our assistant superintendent comes from, I think they've lost in their school system 20% of their kids. They go to Lee Lennox, Greylock, Wakona down there because, again, the parents think they're going to get a better option. Another thing they use in some state, well, you're going to make a powerful basketball team because everybody who plays basketball will go to one school, and you know. But I think all that stuff is baloney. I would like to see choice K through 12 throughout the state. I think it would be good. Parents who think their a school's better than the other one, or you know, we could even make something like the old charter school, where one is more academics and one is science and math, one is arts. More, you know, and you can do those kind of schools. I think there's a lot of things we could change and make the system maybe a little better for the parents, where they would get what they think their children need. I don't know.
Presently, we don't have school choice among the elementary students because of charters and.
Other than North Bennington.
And.
The state doesn't allow.
And borders and.
You said other than North Bennington?
Yeah, that's.
Right.
And so does Act 46 impact that? Or does it make it kind of. Are there incentives to either towards or away from additional choice?
I guess buzzed through the index, I don't see, it's not listed as a section.
No.
I'm not aware of that.
It doesn't appear to be addressed unless it's in the detail.
I think you should, you know, contact your representative, Ms. Morrissey, Mr. Campion, Mr. Barton, wherever you have, and tell them that, you know, you can't see why they don't have choice for the youngsters when they do for the high school, you know. what's the point? Ninth grader can't drive to high school. I mean, the parents still gotta get them there.
And that's one of the things we can look at as a committee when we're looking at educational benefits is.
We can open enrollment.
Open, you know, school.
Open enrollment.
Is that something, Jim, that the state allows? If all the boards in SU got together and said we would be for choice?
I think yes, but I think transportation would be an issue.
No, but we could say that part of the deal is your transportation responsibility. If someone in Bennington wanted to go to Powell, they'd have to get their.
If they wanted to go out of, But it's.
They do. They go, I mean, I cannot believe the parents that pick up their kids at school. I just cannot believe it. With the money that is spent on transportation, the number of parents that are picking Molly Stark, Monument, Bennell, Shasberry. I can't speak for Woodford. I don't know what they do in Powell, but I'm telling you, I cannot believe.
My grandkids are picked up on Tuesdays and Thursdays.
The parents that are sitting outside of these buildings.
Waiting
every single day. And I'm thinking, all that money we're spending on busing.
So it sounds to me like no. Not at this time do we have the option of school choice, and it's not, from what I see, part of the Act 46 discussion.
Is MAU our model? Is that?
It's been mentioned as a model. I don't, you know, well, the way MAU functions.
MAU works fine.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm all in.
MAU went over. I'm calling this adjourned this meeting.
Are you making that a motion that we should?
We got a second. Let's
form K through 12, like pre-K through 12.
No, I'm just inquiring that it sounds like we're drifting towards the MAU model.
Just one thing to bring up. I talked with some of the people from up north, and they were telling me that to help the superintendent out with the number of meetings they have once a month those round robins. Like if we
carousel meetings
in a gymnasium, we'd have the Powell, Shasberry, North Bennington, Woodford group.
Get rollerblades.
And the superintendent and the designee would be running each one, and if they had questions. And they said once it's organized correctly, it runs smoothly. And then once a month, you have your SU meeting.
That.
So you end up with basically two nights out a month instead of, what do you say, eight meetings a month?
Yeah, but he'd be mad if he couldn't.
I would love to attend a couple of those because we tried carousels a couple times here.
It's the organization that has to be done correctly.
I move we adjourn.
Second, let's go. Jim.
Thank you all. Thank you, Donna, for your outstanding camera work.
Why are you the camera person?
She went through the training.
$25 for the SU.
Yeah, right.